Welcome to the sixth presentation in our Gaia Then and Now series. My name is Tom Singer, and I've been hosting this series in which we explore the relationships between the mythopoetic and scientific ways of knowing. An overlapping area of exploration are the relationships between spirit and nature as we try to understand how to deal with climate change in an age in which the natural world has been desacralized. As you will soon witness, Jeffrey Kiehl's marriage of a mythopoetic vision with a keen scientific mind and eye are an extraordinary ending to this first season of our Eris Gaia Then and Now series. I want to say first a few words to introduce our moderator for this session, who, as you will learn, is a perfect fit for introducing and discussing today's presentation by Jeffrey Kiehl, in that we're going to have a wonderful kind of conversation between somebody, between Patricia Losis, who's thoroughly grounded in the arts, and Jeffrey Kiehl, who's thoroughly grounded in science. Patricia is a Jungian analyst in private practice in New York. She earned her undergraduate degree in archaeology and art history from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and did graduate work at the School of Visual Arts. For more than 20 years, she worked as an administrator and educator at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. A graduate of Marion Woodman's Body, Soul, Rhythms leadership training program and a Woodman Foundation faculty and board member, she has taught workshops in Ireland, Japan, Mexico, Peru, and Spain. And presently, she serves on the boards of the National Association for the Advancement of Psychoanalysis Gradiva Awards, which Eris has won twice, I might mention, and the Archive for Research into Archetypal Symbolism, which is maybe why Eris won two of those awards. Patricia is also on the faculty of the Assisi Institute and the Jungian Psychoanalytic Association. More personally, in terms of tonight's presentation, Patricia spent the earliest years of her life living in the Amazon jungle. So she has deep personal feelings about the depletion of the Amazon basin as a resource for carbon sequestration and for maintaining a healthy climate. She's especially interested in mandalas, another key feature of tonight's presentation, as she's been a volunteer at the Rubin Museum of Himalayan Art in New York and participated in their dreamovers, where people are invited to sleep and hopefully dream under mandalas and other art in the collection. So I can't think of anybody who better represents the mythopoetic side of our our attempt to bring together the mythopoetic and scientific ways of knowing. So it's with great pleasure that I introduce Patricia as tonight's moderator.
And the introduction you just heard was pre-recorded because, unfortunately, he was unable to join us tonight. But we have a unique opportunity tonight, as Tom mentioned, that we're going to be hearing from someone who is equally conversant. He has a solid footing in the realms of both science and spirit. And I think that indeed is a rare and unique combination. And I'm really looking forward to hearing the talk tonight from Jeffrey Kiehl. Jeffrey is a diplomate Jungian analyst and senior training analyst for the C.G. Jung Institute of Colorado and the Interregional Society of Jungian Analysts. As scientist and researcher, he carried out climate research for 40 years at the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Colorado. As a teacher, He has been a faculty member at the University of California, Santa Cruz and Pacifica Graduate Institute. As a writer, an author, he has written a book on the subject that we're going to be hearing from him tonight. The book is titled Facing Climate Change, An Integrated Path to the Future. And it provides a Jungian view on climate change. And beyond that, he has written many articles on archetypes and art, on the green man, US cultural complexes, and climate change. So that being said, I hand over the stage to our presenter for this evening, Jeffrey. So look forward to hearing your talk.
Thank you very much, Patricia. I appreciate the invitation from Aras to be a part of this Gaia project. I'm really honored to be here this evening. I'm looking forward to engaging with all of you out there in questions and answers and having a discussion with Patricia after my presentation. So let me just begin with the topic at hand, which is Mandala as an archetypal portal to engage climate chaos. Notice that I don't use the word climate change in this presentation. The scientific community used that term for decades, and we're shifting over to more dire messages to try to emphasize that we are changing, but we're changing it at an unprecedented rate and magnitude. It's occurring right now, and it will continue to occur over the unfolding decades until we provide action to address this. I also want to mention a response to something Tom mentioned, which is the desacralization of the world. This is a central theme of the talk that I'll be giving in terms of mandala. You know, Jung once mentioned in an interview that the problem of today's world is that we have desacralized our relationship with the world, and in particular with nature. And mandalas act as a way, a creative way, an imagistic way to resacralize our relationship with each other, as well as the more than human world. So with that, I'd like to first look at what Jung called the spirit of the times, essentially what is happening right now in the world with respect to climate chaos, the climate system. Where are we now? Where are we going, and why? This is one of my favorite quotes from Jung: one cannot dispose of facts by declaring them unreal. This statement has become even more important over the last 10 years or so, 8 or 10 years of within the United States, where we're living in a world where you can create any fact that you want, whether it's true or not. And so what I'm going to present you with are the scientific facts of where we are. These are facts that can't be altered, they can't be changed, they cannot be imagined to be different. They are what they are. They're based on observing the world all over the place every day. It's been going on for over a century now. So I want to summarize where we are. This is a curve that you probably see in the news. It comes out every year, and it's the white curve is the temperature. It's a deviation from a long-term mean. And so the temperature is in white. It has a jagged nature to it because there are year-to-year fluctuations in the climate system, which are an inherent part of this complex system that we live in. But you notice that on top of that jagged year-to-year variation, you're, as you go to the right, as you head more and more to the years 2020, the curve accelerates upward or moves upward, especially after you get past around 1970. And we'll see a different manifestation of this in a moment. And then the blue curve is the amount of carbon dioxide measured in the atmosphere. And we've been measuring this directly for the last 60 or 70 years, and indirectly you can infer it through various means prior to that. And I mean, the take-home message here is that as carbon dioxide has increased in the atmosphere, the planet has warmed. And indeed, we know why that, we understand the science of this very well. It's been actually understood since the 1850s, this connection between the temperature of the planet and how much carbon dioxide in the, there is in the atmosphere. And another point to make, the latest data point for the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere just came out this past week. It's now 420 parts per million this year, which means that we haven't had this much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere for millions of years. The last time it was that high was around 4 million years ago due to natural processes. And it took millions of years to get to that level. We've done it through human action. We've returned the atmosphere to that level in just over a century. Of course, it's not just temperature that we see on the thermometers that's increasing year by year. What we do see are the manifestations of that, the symptoms of climate chaos are all around us. The Greenland ice sheet and Antarctic ice sheet are melting at phenomenal rate. There's more and more intense heat waves that are lasting for weeks. Those have devastating effects on human life and non-human life. Tens of thousands of people die every year through excessive heat waves, and those heat waves are becoming more intense and more frequent due to climate chaos. There's storm surging that's destroying coastal regions. We see this every year. Periodically, a storm forms, goes up, say, the east coast of US, causing tens, if not 30 or 40, $50 billion damage in a single day or two due to these storm surges. There's flooding occurring. There's drought. I live in California, where we're experiencing a tremendous drought. We have been for years. We're under extreme water stress at this point. When you get that dry, it doesn't take much to start forest fires. And of course, the number and extent of forest fires has been increasing dramatically over the last few years, again, due to that warming trend. And then, of course, associated with these droughts and deforestation, there's also things like mudslides, which create havoc. These are all local phenomena that we're all experiencing now in our local communities. So this is a global problem, but it's being felt now more and more year after year. It's being felt at your local level. And some of you, wherever you live, may have your own stories to tell about how this is showing up in your lives and the lives of the people you love. I want to show you how some people are taking this scientific information, and they're playing with it in creative ways to show, to exhibit this warming in different manifestations. And this is something that was created a few years ago. And when I saw this appear, it was a scientist who created this mandala. He didn't call it a mandala, but that's certainly what I thought it was. And this is taking that temperature data for each month and plotting that deviation for each month for each year. So you can see the year ticking off in the center. And you can see that the circle, it keeps circling around, a very tight circle. You know, it's very confined to that center of the mandala. And it goes on and on like that. You know, it gets a little warmer in the 40s. And it actually cools off in the 50s again. So this is all really natural variability. The human impact hasn't kicked in yet, but it's now going to start to kick in once we get into the 70s. And you see this circle expanding more and more further out to the 1 degree centigrade level of warming. You can even see that the winters are warming preferentially in the northern hemisphere over other months of the year. And there are now months that have exceeded that 1 degree limit. January and February are above the 1 degree threshold. And if you tilt this mandala, you get this container. I look at this as the container that we're now living in. And that container, as we continue to rely on fossil fuels, is just going to grow and expand out. It's like this vase that's going to get redder and redder, and it's going to flange out more and more as we go from year to year. So where are we going? That's where we are. Where are we going? Again, this is taking that data and just projecting out over the next 10 to 30 years. And if we just stay on the track of warming that we have been for the last 40 years, that's this dash curve, we're going to cross 1.5 degrees centigrade warming in about 11 years. Okay, around a decade from now, the global temperature of the planet will have warmed 1.5 degrees centigrade. Why is that important? It's important because the Paris Accord that was signed a number of years ago was set in place to limit planetary warming to below 1.5 degrees centigrade. And clearly that's, I personally don't see how we can possibly do that given how long we've now put off acting on this issue. And more shocking is that by 2059, a mere 36 years from now, 35 to 36 years from now, we're going to hit 2 degrees centigrade warming. And that is catastrophic. The weather phenomena that are going to be, that will be associated with a 2 degree warming, it's going to stress human civilization. There are going to be communities that are going to collapse. The tropical belt, much of Africa and other places in the tropics in South America are going to be literally unlivable. The temperatures will be so high, the humidities will be so high that living organisms won't be able to exist in those regions. And so what will people do? What will living organisms do? They'll migrate to the north and to the south. This is already happening. There are communities, peoples in the world that are leaving their homes in the tropics because they're unsustainable and they're moving to the northern hemisphere in particular, which is causing a tremendous amount of social problems. So 1.5 degrees is quite worrisome, and we really need to keep the temperature less than that. 2 degrees is catastrophic. And so the question is, will we be able to avoid those temperatures? And the only way to really do that is to address the physical cause. And the physical cause of that warming is we rely to 85% or more of our energy, global energy needs and desires are met through the burning of fossil fuels. These are fuels that were created millions of years ago. There were plants that took the sun's energy, took in that sun's energy and created plant matter. That plant matter died. And if it was on land, it was compacted and turned into coal. And if it was organisms in the ocean that took up that sunlight, they died and went to the bottom of the ocean and they became oil. Okay. And so here we are over the last roughly 200 years through our technologies, we discover that you can burn these fuels and you can get heat from them, you can get light from them, energy from them. And we have excelled at extracting over just 150 years, extracting all of that sunlight that's been stored for millions of years, and we've been burning it like mad. The amount that we burn keeps accelerating. Part of that's due to the fact that there are more people on the planet year after year. We're approaching 8 billion people on the planet. And the other problem associated with that is those people, we are burning more and more energy, using more and more energy year after year. So it's not only the amount of number of people on the planet, it's that our consumption, our rate of consumption is increasing. We're a very hungry species for energy. And until we can address those issues, the planet's going to continue to warm. It's really, I hate to say it, but it's that simple in terms of the science. This is a just breaking out who's contributing most to this problem. And these are the carbon, and this is another mandala. So you take all the countries that are emitting burning fossil fuels and emitting carbon, and you divide that amount of carbon emitted by the number of people in the country. So this is the carbon emission per capita for each country. And you can see that the United States by far is on a per capita basis is emitting more carbon than the rest of most other countries in the world. Now, in terms of total carbon emitted, because there are far more people in China, China for the last few years has been the leader in terms of emitting carbon in the atmosphere. But you compare these numbers, 14, 7, to a country like India or African countries, the developed world is, burning and consuming 10 times the energy than the rest of many other country in the world. Okay. And so there, and yet those other countries, remember I said Africa and South American countries, Pacific Island countries, they're the ones who are going to suffer and are suffering the most right now. So there's a tremendous social inequity issue associated with global chaos, in that the rich nations burn most of the fuel and warm the planet more than any other part of the world. And yet it's that other part of the world, the poorer part of the world, that suffers the most. And that's going to continue until the developed world can rein in its emissions. So that's the physical picture. That's, as I spoke to you then as a scientist who's looked at this problem for many decades, along with thousands of other scientists. And that's the consensus view of where we are with this problem. But what has intrigued me over the many years is, what's the psychological reason for this? We know, the science is telling us, if you continue to rely on these fuels, if you continue to dig them up and burn them, you're going to continue to warm the planet more and more and more, to the point that the planet's going to be more uninhabitable for humans as well as non-humans. So why would we want to do that? Why would we want to deny the reality of the facts of the science and continue on our merry way of emitting more and more carbon into the atmosphere? And for me, the question, to answer that question, I have to look at that psychologically. Yes, there are socioeconomic reasons, but those too are rooted in psychology. So what I've spent a large part of my time over the past many years is, what are the depth psychological dimensions of climate chaos? And if we could understand those, could we do a better job at addressing the reasons for us not acting on this quick enough? Action is occurring. We can't deny that there's a lot of action occurring, but it's not enough, and it's not happening fast enough to keep us from hitting those thresholds of 1.5 and 2 degrees centigrade. So I'm just going to talk about a few reasons, psychological reasons. And at the core of each of these is a basic belief system that has been encoded in our cultural, the cultural psyche of the West for millennia. And that is the belief of separation, that I am separate from you. We are all separate from the natural world. We are separate from the material world, and my actions don't really affect, certainly they don't affect others halfway around the world, which we know is incorrect, okay? So this basic belief, and we've created mythic structures, religious structures that support this tenet of separation. And each of these systems that have grown out of that belief system, infinite growth, loss of the sacred, materialism, competition over cooperation. They all are self-fulfilling in terms of reinforcing our separation from the world. So for me, this is the psychological mandala, the depth psychological mandala that we have to work on. You know, that our economic system is rooted in the belief that the economy has to grow year after year after year. So the belief of infinite growth is a fallacy. We live on a finite planet with finite resources. There's no way that we can sustain infinite growth. And yet our political systems, our politicians, our economists all have bought in to the belief system that we have to eternally grow, that we can infinitely grow. Our detachment from the sacred, as I mentioned at the beginning, the loss of the sacred, devalues the world that we live in. We lose the transpersonal connection. We lose the valuing of the natural world to the point that we can go out and deforest the Amazon. We can destroy large, vast areas of the world. We can melt the Greenland ice sheet and the Antarctic ice sheet through our actions. So those are some of the cultural complexes that we are embedded in that all rise for this sense of separation, or Jung would call it dissociation. Okay. So quote from Jung: for a collective problem, and indeed climate chaos is truly a collective problem, for a collective problem, the cause of the disturbance is not to be sought in the personal surroundings, but rather in the collective situation. And here's something that Jung was pointing out to his own community. Psychotherapy has hitherto taken this matter far too little into account. Okay, so even those of us who work in the psychotherapy world, the analytical psychology world, the psychoanalytic world, and I can speak to this from personal experience. Those communities are very ill prepared to work with and deal with psychologically the eco-anxiety, the pre-stress that's occurring, that's being generated. And there are articles about this in the paper more and more, how people are psychologically suffering due to the symptoms of climate change. So Jung is saying this is a collective problem. We have to look at the collective psyche to really understand what's going on. So this requires us to leave the spirit of the times for a moment and go into the spirit of the depths. Of course, these are coexistent. We don't leave the spirit of the times behind, but we're changing our gaze, turning our gaze now to what Jung called the spirit of the depths. In other words, we're going to plumb the depths of psyche to understand this. So this collective issue, here's another quote from Jung: nations have their own peculiar psychology, and in the same way, they also have their own particular kind of psychopathology. And I would say we are in a very heightened state of psychopathology, not just in this country, but globally. But my focus has really been on the United States, because I live here, but also because the United States has been the most resistant country in the world to act on this issue of climate change. And I want to understand that psychopathology. It consists in the accumulation of a large number of abnormal features, the most striking of which is a suggestibility affecting the entire nation. Well, technology has played a huge role. Technologies that Jung could not have dreamt of have played a huge role in this suggestibility. And what I'm referring to here is social media. And we saw the huge role that social media played in the political elections most recently, and how it's leading to divisiveness in the world, and again, in particular in the United States. So that's a psychopathology, that's a dissociation, that out of that comes alienation and inaction around issues like not just climate chaos, but in particular climate chaos. So what I'm arguing here is that we're in a state of collective dissociation. What does that mean? For Jung, dissociation first and foremost meant it's a detachment of the conscious realm from the unconscious realm, that the conscious realm begins to believe it's the only thing that matters. It has the ego has complete control of its destiny or fate, and that the messages that come from the unconscious are either meaningless or so abstract and so metaphoric that they cannot be interpreted, or not with worth listening to. That is a tremendous dissociation. And out of that comes things like a dissociation from nature. Okay, the more our intellect develops, the more one-sided we become, the more we devalue the natural world. So all of these are manifestations of dissociation that contribute to the psychopathology. So if that is the illness, then the question is, how do you heal the dissociation? And of course, this was Jung's work from this very beginning. He was in a dissociated state after leaving his collaboration with Freud. And so he was a man who was very attuned to what dissociation feels like, how one personally experiences it. But he was also the witness of the two world wars, the witness of the dropping of two bombs on Japan, atomic bombs, the witness of the falling of the Iron Curtain. All of those are collective manifestations of dissociation. And so this is where I want to bring in mandala as a potential agent, a portal into working with this dissociation. And how does that happen? Well, it actually happens very spontaneously in individuals and in collectives. Mandala symbols appeal very frequently in moments of psychic disorientation as compensatory ordering factors. There's something in our psyches that sees the disorder inside of us and the disorder outside of us and engages with that disorder and tries to bring order to it. Another quote, mandalas mostly appear in connection with chaotic psychic states of disorientation or panic. Well, that's certainly where we are. They then have the purpose of reducing the confusion to order. At all events, they express order, balance, and wholeness. So there's this striving towards wholeness that a part of us, the archetype of wholeness, wants to emerge through us, okay, in order to work with this chaotic state that's both in us and in the world that we've created. Jung's connection to the mandala is very interesting. In 1898, as a young man, he had a dream. He was in the woods. I saw a circular pool. Half immersed in the water lay the strangest and most wonderful creature. There's a numinosity there that comes with mandalas. That's one of the things that distinguishes a mandala from, a picture or just a drawing. Okay, it carries this numinosity. A round animal, shimmering in opalescent hues. It was a giant radiolarian. Here's an electron microscopic picture of a radiolarian. Okay. By the way, these radiolarians are the organisms in the ocean that absorb the carbon dioxide and trap it in their organisms. And then when they die, they go to the bottom of the ocean and they bury that captured carbon. And as we put more and more carbon in the atmosphere, the ocean becomes more acidic and these radiolarians can't form. Okay, which is another cascade effect associated with the burning of fossil fuels. Nothing to do with temperature. It has everything to do with your acidifying the oceans. And at the bottom of the food chain, you get this collapse in microorganisms. Later, Jung draws this beautiful mandala, which is this system of the world. Okay, it's a very Gnostic image. Spontaneously came out of his psyche. This is in later 1925. This is his mandala of psyche, his picture of how we are in the world, our being in the world, from a, which portrays the self-regulation of the psyche, which is you have this central archetype of the self that's going to produce these mandalas, these ordering principles, to counteract the disorder that the consciousness and parts of the unconscious are creating. And, you know, I just want to point out one of the last mandalas he created was at Bollingen when he carved the stone. And on one facing side of the stone, there is the beautiful mandala that he created. So here is a man who is allowing mandala to flow through him and work through him creatively, imagistically, and provided him with tremendous meaning. And of course, that's the essence of a mandala. It's a numinous symbol that provides us with a sense of meaning. It connects us. It doesn't disconnect us. It connects us. It's archetypal. And that means that you should be able to see these mandalas through time. And indeed, again, Jung, knowledge of the common origin of these unconsciously preformed symbols has been totally lost to us. This is a part of the dissociation process. When we penetrate a little more deeply below the surface of the psyche, we come upon historical layers, which are not just dead dust, but alive and continuously active in everyone. Maybe to a degree that we cannot imagine in the present state of our knowledge. So what's being asked of us here is that we know these images have appeared through time, and here's one from Western United States, okay? A mandala painting from the indigenous peoples in the United States. And that our separation from the world has led to us losing the ability to imagine that these can emerge, not just as it to individuals, but they can be messages to humanity. This is one of my favorite, and this is probably the oldest mandala that I know of. It was not created by Homo sapien. It was created by Neanderthal. And it's in a cave in France, and it's 175,000 years old. And this is a formation of stalactites that were broken off, 400 of them, stalagmites that were broken off, some of them weighing over a ton, and were carried or dragged to an area, and they were formed into a circle with a center stalagmite in the center by Neanderthal. Very numinous, a very important discovery. Very interesting when you read these, the archaeologists that are talking about this in the paper that this appeared, is they're speculating why Neanderthal would build something like this. What would be its function? What would be its reason, the reason to build it? Well, from my perspective, it's the archetype of oldness working through Neanderthal, creating a sacred ritualistic space for them to connect to the transcendent. Okay, that's what mandalas do. That's its purpose. Whether they're conscious of it or not, they're guided to produce this beautiful mandala 175,000 years ago. And again, Jung, because it is a question of characteristically human modes, in other words, these are innate in us, not just human, Neanderthal, it is hardly wondered that we can find psychic forms which occur in other epochs with which archaeology provides the only link. So you can see these through the history of humanity, through the history of our relatives, the hominids, okay? I'm sure there are probably even older mandalas that go further back than 175,000 years, but you can see how important these are to us, okay? They will out. And here's a modern mandala created by a group of scientists. And this is the trajectory that the Earth, planet Earth, has followed for billions of years, okay? It can get cold and lock into glacial states. And then it can, if the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere goes up through volcanism, it can flip into a hothouse state. And you can see that right here, we're in the stabilized point where Earth has been for the last million years or so, last out of the last ice age cycles, last 20,000 years. And now through the human action of burning fossil fuels, we're heating the planet up. And the question is, can we stabilize Earth and keep it down here? Or is it going to fly off into a state that it hasn't been in for 40 to 50 to 100 million years? And if it does, then there are dramatic implications for extinction at that point, because we know Earth from deep time studies of Earth. That's the research that I carried out for a long time, looking at the mass extinctions of Earth's past and how they were climatically driven. Well, we're in one of those right now, and it's being caused by one species, the human species. So how can we work with Mandala in concert with the challenges of climate chaos? I think there is a sense here that Mandala can come, psyche can appear in forms that could provide us with some answers above and beyond what science is and technology is providing. The sickness of dissociation in our world is at the same time a process of recovery, or rather the climax of a period of pregnancy, which heralds the throes of birth. So, you know, this is the so-called enantiodromia, the flip in psyche that can occur both personally and collectively. This has happened through history, where you get to a state where things are so disordered, so disorganized, that you can have the appearance of a transcendent symbol. This is from my book, and this is an African ceremony where you have the storyteller. This is a mandala. Mandalas are human as well. Human organizations can be mandala. So this indigenous tribe has gathered to form a mandala, and they're listening to a storyteller. Okay, given the power of symbols, it is important for us to be conscious of what images, patterns, or metaphors could activate transformation. So this is, for me, where the arts come in. The humanities and the arts are so gifted in the realm of images, patterns, and metaphors. So the more we invite, we being the scientific community, but also the psychological community, the analytical psychology community, to work with the people who are immersed in, those people who are immersed in image, pattern, and metaphor, we could open ourselves up to seeing mandalic images that inform the collective. So the ideal situation here is you have a living symbol or a set of symbols that cohere you, that integrate, that keep you connected to each other as a society, but also keep you integrated within the global ecosystem. Okay, and we are now out of balance. We have entered a state of disintegration. And that's because we don't have these living symbols that provide us with the connectors to things like, you know, our ecosystems that we're in. I mean, ecosystem is a mandala too, that works very well, dynamically, very well. But, you know, then you have one species like the human species that comes in and can obliterate a local ecosystem. So if a symbol, a living symbol or symbols can reappear, of course, the word symbol comes from the Greek for thrown together. In other words, it doesn't disintegrate, it reintegrates. Then, you know, you can address the fragmentation that's occurring around climate chaos. So we have an ecological psyche within us, okay? And this is a beautiful sculpture by Kate McDowell. It shows what I would consider the ecological psyche. And Jung says the unconscious produces contents which are valid, not only for the person concerned, but for others as well. In fact, for a great many people and possibly for all. Okay. So we're not just talking about we personally listening to our dreams, which we should all be doing or hopefully doing, okay, so that we get those messages. But some of those dreams speak beyond the personal realm. You know, a year ago, I had a dream about the manatee. And at the time I looked up the manatee, it was not under threat from human actions. Since then, the manatee's actual survival has now on the edge of collapse, okay? Mostly not through climate change, but by the pollution of coastal waters. And it's suffocating them and they're dying, okay? And so I have to look at that is more than a year ago, the manatee came to me and a fellow colleague of mine. We were under the water and we saw a woman in scuba gear who was an environmental marine biologist who was working with the manatee. Okay. So for me, I have to look at that as psyche, the psyche of manatee coming to me and warning me and telling me what's happening to their species. Okay. Some, to some of you, that may sound absolutely beyond comprehension, but that's how psyche works. It transcends space and time. It's doing it every night in our psyches. And I just want to point out the image that appeared in that dream was that of a mandala, a manatee, the woman, myself and my colleague. And then there were three threatening men behind the woman and the manatee, symbolic of that masculine force that wants to come down and stop the saving of the manatee. I love the work of Andy Goldsworthy. He is an artist who works with nature. All of his materials that he uses, he goes out into nature. His installations are, some of them are massive, some of them are small. But he is here's an artist who is working in direct connection with nature to create these beautiful mandalic forms. Here's another one. This was in the Presidio in San Francisco. And then there are technological mandalas. These are engineers that are working on technological ways to get us off of carbon, fossil fuels, and to eliminate the emission of carbon. So, you know, there's a lot of creative imagination, both in the scientific world, the engineering world, and in the artistic world, to create mandalas that are very meaningful and speak to us in terms of what we can actually do around this issue of climate chaos. This is a mandala I put together, and it's our future. These are children. This is all began with Greta Thunberg a few years ago, who stopped going to school because she realized she has no future. The children of her age have no future if we continue on this trajectory of ever more warming and climate chaos. And so this has grown to a multi-million global phenomena. Every Friday, kids and their parents are going out marching to stop our reliance on fossil fuels. And I quote from my book, "Movement to Wholeness requires a radical transformation in how we see the world." That's really what's required right now. Time has run out. We need a radical transformation in consciousness. Okay, and if it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen within the next decade or so, then we are truly committing these children and every child on the planet to tremendous suffering, unimaginable suffering, because the climate that's going to exist in another 20 or 30 years is a climate that hasn't existed on this planet for millions and millions of years before the human species has appeared on this planet. That's what we're bequeathing our children and grandchildren. Okay, so I want to now shift one level, and I want to finish with union of spirit of the depths and the union of the spirit of times. As I mentioned, these aren't separate, okay? They're interdependent. They're completely connected. It's actually an illusion that they're separate. And so this has also been a focus of Jung's work. You know, he says our psyche is set up in accord with the structure of the universe, and what happens in the macrocosm, that is the cosmos as a whole, likewise happens in the infinitesimal and most subjective reaches of the psyche. We are, each of us, as an individual and as a collective, as a society, as nations, as a global community, integrally connected to the cosmos. This is a very old idea. It's in most spiritual traditions around the world. You can see it over and over. It's in ancient Greek philosophy. And it's, you know, if you can place yourself in that belief, and you can actually experience that, then you do have that shift, that radical shift in consciousness. Wholeness has always been characterized by certain cosmic affinities. The individual soul was thought to be of heavenly origin, a particle of the world soul, and hence a microcosm, a reflection of the macrocosm. This is a study that was done almost 10 years ago. It was published in a science journal called Current Biology. The dung beetle rolls its dung ball in a certain direction. And biologists wanted to understand why, what was orienting the dung beetle to roll its dung ball in a particular direction. And they tried all sorts of ways of explaining it, and they finally used a planetarium, ingenious scientific experiment, and they projected different astronomical objects in the planetarium, the moon, the sun, the this, the that, the stars. It turns out that this beetle uses the skylight of the Milky Way as its compass to orient itself in how to roll its dung ball. Now, if ever there is a cosmic affinity between the macrocosm and the microcosm, it's just unbelievable that this is how this, and yet it's true, this is what the dung beetle does. So my feeling is if that dung beetle can fall into a state and be in a state where it's orienting itself in its cosmos, its microcosm, using the macrocosmic light of the Milky Way, then I think it's incumbent upon us as humans to also find ways of orienting ourselves and connecting ourselves to the greater cosmos. So mandalas create order out of chaos. They can address an issue like collective dissociation. They create a sacred relationship with our world and worlds. They create a sense of community. Every community is a mandala. We're in a mandala right now. All of you have shown up here. We've created a mandala. And what mandalas are arising around global chaos or climate warming, okay, climate chaos or global warming. So, you know, we should be on the lookout in the collective, in our personal dreams, for the mandalas that may be emerging and in response to the chaotic disorder that's ever present every day in the world that we live in, and that's emerging out of our imbalance within ourselves, and that imbalance within ourselves is manifesting as an imbalance in the world, in a symptom like climate chaos. So that's the end of this part of the presentation, and I hope it's the beginning. I hope that what I've done is to excite you enough, get you curious enough to go in and go out and search for the mandalas that are providing that sense of cosmic affinity and can help reorient yourself. So I want to finish now. The next thing I'm going to do is play a short video that I made, a slide sound video, music video, that will walk you through how I played with the idea of cosmic affinities. So I'm going to start that right now. It takes about 6 minutes. Thank you.
Jeffrey, it's almost hard to speak after that. You really took us to a place of, I guess what came to me was the reminder of the importance of reverie with the numinous, but at the same time, the music you chose, you know, was so containing and holding with the rhythm. So I was feeling all those opposites of both containment and holding, but then the expansion of reverie and the expansion of the images. And it was a very different experience. It's interesting, again, as you said, this is a mandala to feel, you know, I got so excited with the dung beetle. I was just, you know, and also seeing those images of Neanderthal man. And so it was very interesting from the point of view of, you know, the spectrum of emotions and not sort of dissociating from any of them, you know, but sort of trying to hold them all together to feel the excitement. And then again, the quality that this last piece that you shared with us brought. So I feel, first of all, tremendous gratitude for the sobering nature of your call. But also, you really, I felt, gave us the experience of stepping into, you know, a more mythopoetic, numinous space with that last piece. Yeah, really, really touched. One of the things that came to me, or as you were speaking, and with this, is that you have such a feeling for images. Scientific images, which I usually don't have any connection to myself, like the temperature spiral mela. It was so beautiful. So I wanted to just ask you what your relationship to images has been, or if there's any spark, because obviously you have such a sensitivity to art, and I wonder about that trail of libido for you.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Patricia. Yeah, I liked your use of the word reverie. I think that's what I attempt to do. I think that's what we, if we can get into that state, it provides a container. But that container can be very organic. It can expand out when it needs to, and then it can, you know, contract again. I'll just say it's an image that's actually put me on this path many years ago. I was looking at a science image of where we're going in the future. And I just was so shocked by, you know, staggered by the implications of where we're heading in this century, that I stopped. I literally stopped everything that I was doing. And I just, my mantra became, why are we doing this? We now know enough, and this was 20 years ago, we now know enough to be not doing this, and yet we continue on the same path. And so that image grabbed me, and it pushed me into looking at the psychological dimensions of, you know, of this issue. And then what arose from that was, I had been going out into scientific, not public communities, as a scientist, giving, you know, informational talks on this issue. But it was, at some point, something woke up within me and said, I need to ask another question, not, you know, do you understand the science? Or are there any questions about the science? I need to ask, how are you feeling? Mm-hmm. How are you feeling? Really feeling now that you've seen what's happening and where we're going. And that opens, of course, a whole other part, a whole other dimension, because, you know, now you're allowing people to speak from their hearts about how this chaos is entering their lives, their personal lives, the lives of their communities. And then the next step was, how do I give voice to this through image? Okay. How do you bring in the arts? How do you work with images in different ways? And I'll give you one last thing that I thought of in the moment you were speaking. I belong to a small dream group that's focused on climate change, climate issues. That's what we, you know, if we have dreams. And this was, and I have permission from my friend to tell this story. She lives in Sydney. And this was just at the fires a couple of years ago were burning in Australia. And I don't know if you know, but close to 2 billion animals burned alive in those fires. Okay. And that's just, and there was nothing in the headlines of newspapers about that. Okay. It was in the back pages. Certainly it was in the news of Australia, barely made it into the Northern Hemisphere. And I, you know, that's, I could hardly speak for a week or so, based, you know, just holding that destruction. And she had a dream, which she was outside the Sydney Opera House, and more people were collecting. More and more people were collecting. And she asked someone, what's going on? What's happening? And someone said, oh, there's going to be a performance of Mozart's Requiem. And it was a performance for those lost. And we're talking about the non-human world, okay? And I was so moved by that night I couldn't sleep. I stayed up and put together a slideshow of animals facing extinction. And the background music is the first movement of Mozart's Requiem. And I've shown that to people, you know, to groups. And it's a very, very difficult video to watch. And it's deeply moving. But here's an example of a dream comes to her. She tells our group, it's placed me in a state of reverie. And there's something in me that needs to create the mandala. Okay. And I'm just listening to the dream. And then my thought was, why don't we do this? Why don't every year around the world there are performance of Mozart's Requiem to honor all that we're losing year after year? I mean, the number of species that are going extinct every year is phenomenal. So we need to start creating rituals to bring awareness to this, but also for us to hold the emotions, the feeling, the affect that's associated with the destruction that we're causing. This is us, okay? We have to own that. And so that's the power of mandala, that's the part of power of art, that's the power of psyche, that these messages are coming to us as individuals, but they can be taken as messages to create things that can be given to humanity. Some Neanderthal had a dream. Let's go break stalagmites.
Mel Brooks might have something to say about that. You know, from the collective perspective, there is something that I heard about that was very touching. I don't know if you've heard of the the Kogi people.
Yes.
Yeah. Colombia.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I have a friend who has gone down and spent time with them and listened to their stories and the message they have for us, the rest of the world.
Yes. Well, I was thinking of what you were saying about the awakening and how, you know, this is a people that has lived a very sheltered and isolated life, and they've sort of lived far away from the modern world. They call themselves the elders, and they live on, you know, the mountaintops of the Santa Marta Mountains, and they have a way of, their belief is sort of weaving the world into being. And they have a whole spiritual practice, which they maintain. But I was so struck that I think it was in the collective call or a collective dream, and they actually left the mountains to contact a filmmaker and say, you know, we have to make a film to tell modern men that we are way, way too out of balance.
Right.
Their whole ethos is, again, as you said, about staying in balance. And it was very touching to me to feel that there was this collective sense there of responsibility.
Absolutely.
To tell us. And then I think there was a second film because they said, you didn't listen. You know, as you know, we haven't listened.
Right.
And it's very sobering. Very sobering. There's a few questions here.
Okay.
First of all, there's a message from Mary who says, I would like to play your video every morning. I think she can, right, Jeffrey?
Yeah.
Isn't it on YouTube?
I think it is, yeah.
Okay.
It is. If it's not, I happily give it out to whoever wants it. So.
Okay.
I have a movie version of it. You know, you can just play it on your
Well, computer. I think it may be available on the IRIS website.
So okay, great.
Also a place. And then Cecile very much appreciates your talk and framing of the issue and says that as a researcher, I have been engaged in some work about eco-anxiety awareness and have come to believe that arts-based materials have a greater chance at shifting consciousness than reason-based material. What has been your experience, Jeffrey, of the balance between facts and arts to engage people in a meaningful way?
Yeah, that's a great question. And all I can say is I, over the last 10 years, the artist community in particular has become more and more engaged with and wants to get more engaged in how to take this information that scientists are generating and what's happened, not just scientists, but, you know, what's happening in the world, and transform it in ways through their gifts, their artistic talents, in a way to reimagine it so that it will engage people not from the sort of the thinking function, but from the intuition feeling function level, speaking in typology language here. In other words, and sensation. So moving away from, you know, that sort of one single perspective, which is sort of the coin of the realm of the scientific world, which is thinking, you know, ideas, mathematics, analysis, analyzing data. And then taking that and reframing it completely. You know, someone has, a composer has taken that time series of temperature and translated it into music, a musical score for an orchestra. So you can sit and listen. You don't see the data, you listen to it. You listen to things becoming, as you get closer and closer to the present, things becoming more chaotic and more dissonant, okay? So there's
a
way.
That's really interesting, right? From the point of view of the inferior function,
yes.
You know, in some way, it's like if we're not willing to see what's in front of us, maybe if we hear it in another form, it'll somehow enter us awaken us.
Yeah. So in working with eco-anxiety, absolutely, you know, people who are experiencing eco-anxiety, you know, they get it to the place of eco-anxiety usually from two sources. One is reading the news every day, which is dire about the climate system. That's the science being filtered through journalists. Or they may have personally experienced something like a flood, a fire, you know, a felt sense experience of climate chaos that's placed them into this state of eco-anxiety. Well, you know, what would help at that point is other avenues to work with the affect that's welling up within them through image, through sound, okay? So I really encourage people to find ways of expressing that anxiety through image, through sound, through dance, through the arts, okay? And there are artists, there's a collective of artists now that are dedicated to, you know, working through with their media, their particular media, to connect people and to work with this sense of anxiety. So yeah, it's a very good question. And it is a way. It is a way to work with that anxiety, very effective way. Because you're out of the, you're in a nonverbal, pre-verbal sort of state at that point. And you know, it's best to work imagistically or through sound or body, you know.
You know, there's an exhibit that recently opened at the Rubin Museum, which is of course where the Red Book was initially
yes,
shown.
Yeah, right.
But they have something that is going to be on view till 2031. So it's certainly on for a while.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
It gives everybody an opportunity if they come to New York to visit it. But they've done something called the Mandala Lab, where emotions can turn to wisdom. And they have, you know, videos and scents and sculpture and sound and different places within the gallery. And they have people like, you know, artists like Laurie Anderson, Peter Gabriel. But it's really a place to go and experiment with a variety of emotions.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's, yeah, we need those containers, because if you don't have that to, and there's also, there's the other thing that I really want to convey to people is form community mandalas. I really encourage, you know, get some friends together, get neighbors together, meet every week or once a month, just sit together and share your what's coming up with you around the issue of climate chaos. It doesn't have to be directed. It can be completely spontaneous, but it's the idea of sitting together. I can't tell you how many people that I've talked to me and said they felt they could not talk to anybody about how, you know, what was going on within them around the issue of climate chaos. They just held it in. And being able to open up to other people and finding out that, you know, we're all feeling this. You know, I feel it every day. And we have to sit with that. We have to be with that. But we also have to be with others. Yeah, in that, yeah. With that, that's a mandala.
That issue that you bring up of separation was so powerful. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I feel that is the root cause of what's all the symptoms that are manifesting out there. Is we have fallen into this complete state of independence, not interdependent, independence. It's that, you know, that's in the ethos of the American psyche.
Well, I will tell you that I have a major beef on a regular basis with Ralph Waldo Emerson. Self-reliance.
Self-reliance, thing.
It's such an ideal, you know, and there's stories about how at the same time he was, you know, his mother was bringing him food in the afternoons. So there's something there. There is a mythology. That really, I know, you know, I come from Peru, and in the Andes, there's this, one of the major tenets of life is called Aini, A-Y-N-I.
Okay.
It sounds like Aini, and it's really about reciprocity, mm-hmm. and that everything is connected. And right. it's, you know, as really it's the image of the mandala. Mm-hmm. You know, if something's mm-hmm. taken away here, it's taken away here. It's interdependence, interconnectedness.
Mm-hmm. So these, you know, this is the cosmology that we as social beings, we create. And they define how we see the world, but also how we relate to one another and the world. Yes. We, you know, the West has created a cosmology of separation, mm-hmm. and it just has, it's self-invested to maintain it, that cosmology. And this is where this idea of the cosmos comes in. We really have to, because a cosmology orients us within our world and worlds that we live in, clearly the cosmology that we have been living in is destroying us. Okay. So we have to create a new cosmology. That's our task. Mm-hmm. That's our task, is to create the new cosmology. It can borrow from, you know, be integrated with other cosmologies, but the one that we're living and have been living for centuries now, if we continue to live it, it will destroy, we will destroy ourselves. So the challenge is, can we find that new cosmology?
I love hearing you say that. I'm taking a leap from, you know, that I always remember Jung's question, what is the mythology in right. which you live? But I don't know what the leap is, but I'm enjoying what is the cosmology?
Yes, what is the cosmology we're living?
Right. Yeah, it's some kind of, there's something to the fact that you're bringing it to the place of cosmology, that there is, time has passed, and mm-hmm. we have a very different
science. Right. And think about the science we're building. You know, we built the Hubble Space Telescope and all those beautiful images that were in that slideshow came from the Hubble. But now we have the James Webb Telescope that's going to look even further back in time with higher resolution. We'll have unbelievably beautiful images of the cosmos coming within this month, I think. So why is that happening now? I have to look at this as this is psyche working through us. There's something in us that wants to connect to the cosmos, to see it, to resolve it, to be connected to it. And so the science part of our psyches creates these instruments, and we put them in space and we look out. But when you see those images, there's something that's touching your heart.
There's a question here from Santiago. He's saying, given that we live in a macrocosmos and that science cannot explain everything that exists, thinking that we can solve this climate crisis, is that not an act of dissociation itself, a kind of manifestation that emerges out of an egocentric vision?
Absolutely. And that's what I hope to bring as a scientist. I recognize mm-hmm. the limits of science and the fallacy of one-sidedness, that if you think that science alone or technology alone is going to get us out of this problem, you're wrong. I'll just be blunt. Or the shadow of those solutions are going to come to haunt us. Okay. So this is why we need to our shift in consciousness, a shift in psyche, this new cosmology. Science and technology have to be an integral part of that, because they do provide us with the physical means of treating the symptom, but they cannot treat the cause. They cannot treat this dissociation, this separateness. And if they think that they can solve it all, then you're absolutely right. They're in a dissociated state. They're in a completely one-sided state, believing, and that is, it's a belief, believing that all of these problems can be solved through the intellect. They can't. They can't be. This is why we need what's often referred to as other ways of knowing. Other ways of knowing the world. This includes dream world. This includes synchronicity. This includes, you know, all sorts of ways of experiencing the world that fall outside of the domain of, you know, physical observation. They have to be a part of that cosmology, or otherwise we're just treating the symptom within, and there's going to be shadow in those treatments. And that's the way we, you know, we are a quick fix society that wants to fix things through technological means. That's our myth. That's our living myth. And that's a living myth that has to go away, to die.
Well, we have one last question here from Matt. Climate chaos seems to fundamentally be about how we refuse to metabolize or integrate our garbage, both literally, symbolically, and psychologically, you know, our shadow, etc. In our efforts to develop ourselves, isn't our longing for spiritual purity part of why we refuse to befriend our regressive energy?
Yes, again, this is another manifestation of one side, a one-sidedness or an aspect of dissociation. You know, we have to, another key element or thread. I always talk about this as a tapestry. You know, we're weaving it. We need to weave a tapestry, and you need different skeins. You need different threads to create a complete or a whole tapestry. And so what's one of the key threads or skeins of yarn that you need for that tapestry? It's shadow. It's becoming aware of your shadow. What is, what's an absolutely essential element of that? Being willing to open your heart to your own vulnerabilities, your own weaknesses, your own frailties, your own failures. Okay. Often that's where shadow lies hidden, is in those places where we're unwilling to open our heart and feel the tremendous vulnerability of our very being. Okay. And so that has to be a part of this cosmology. And if it's not, you're right, we just keep generating waste. And it, you know, we're doing this physically. I mean, we're filling the oceans with plastic, we're our landfills. Typically, when we buy something, we keep it for 3 months and it ends up in the landfill. So this highly overconsumptive behavior is yet another symptom of that belief that, first of all, that we are only ego, and that we don't need to connect to any other parts of psyche. We don't need to listen to wisdom or experience wisdom. As long as we're in that state, we're going to be garbage in, garbage out, as the computer science world knows. So that's a challenge. Yeah, absolutely.
Jeffrey, I can't thank you enough for, first of all, the call, the sobering call, the reminder, and for helping us consider the mandala as a path forward. And before we end, we just have a final message from Tom, who initiated this series, and so he's going to close it for us. But again, thank you, and thank all of you who have joined us and participated in this mandala. As Jeffrey said, it's been very moving, and I hope that we each find our own reverie and way forward to remain connected and not separate from the meaningful call that we've heard tonight. Thank you all so very much.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey and Patricia, for this sensational presentation in which you have grounded us in both the mythopoetic and scientific ways of knowing about climate change and the relationship between spirit and nature. It's just a sensational presentation by Jeffrey and Patricia. Thank you so much for being our moderator and leading a most stimulating conversation. As a closing, I just want to say a couple of things. First of all, we've been so pleased and gotten such positive feedback about this first season of Eris Gaia Then and Now that we're already in discussions about adding additional presentations to this ongoing, what we hope to be an ongoing series of the Eris Then and Now presentations from Eris. I want to remind you that there are ways that you can access tonight's presentation as well as all of the other presentations. And not only that, ways in which you can contribute through our forums and our galleries and our events on the archipelago part of the, which we call an archipelago, the Eris Outreach Center at eris.org archipelago. And in that section, you can, in the form, you can contribute impressions and thoughts about tonight's presentation. In the gallery section, if there are images that you would like to contribute, paintings that you've done, images that you think are relevant to tonight's discussion, we welcome you to post those on the gallery. And finally, in the archipelago, the Eris Outreach Center, you will find a after a few days, you will find a video of tonight's entire presentation, as well as videos of all of our other presentations, should you want to share those with others or review some of these, the material, because there's so much extraordinary material in our that our six presenters have offered to us that you may want to have a use it as a resource. And all of that information, all of those videos will be at the Eris Outreach Center Archipelago. So thank you very much. And I look forward to the next presentation of Eris Gaia Then and Now, the date of which is uncertain.